Hi, I'm Dr. Naftali Serrano. I am the CEO at an organization called the Collaborative Family Healthcare Association, and I've hijacked this YouTube channel for our nonprofit association to do education, all things related to integrated care. Today, we're going to jump right into our topic, which is to refer or not refer. That is the question. So those of you who know me know that I've done this work of integrating physical and behavioral health and primary care for all of my career. And this particular question is one of the most common training points that I've had with students or folks that I'm coaching, and also a key question that I myself have faced as I've worked with patients in our team's care. So it's a really important one. And I'm going to offer up some really tangible questions for you to ask yourself if you're a clinician out there and trying to think through how you develop a threshold for how to refer patients out to specialty mental health. So let's just jump right in. First, some preparatory remarks, right? So one is that in any functional health system, as I've talked about in other videos, you need a primary care level of care to complement a specialty level of care. So by definition, you really don't want the majority of the population going to specialty services, because that will absolutely trash access to those specialty services. So just by default, you should have it in your head that most of the folks that you're going to come in contact with in primary care should stay in primary care. In fact, the large majority. Now, there's no data out there that we can point to that details exactly what that magical number is. But in practice, what I found is upwards of 90% of the community population that you're going to see in primary care really should stay there with you in primary care. Primary care is the right level of care for those folks. It really should be the large minority of folks that you end up referring out. So at a very baseline, if you find yourself referring patients at a rate that's higher than that, you probably should check yourself, and you should really use some of the sort of screening questions that I'm going to talk to you about to refine your threshold. Now, the reason why a lot of folks tend to do that, tend to over-refer to specialty care, especially when they first start working in primary care, is oftentimes because of their discomfort with understanding how to work in primary care with complex issues. And you can refer to some of the other videos I have on working with complex patients and the like. But the reality is that we can do a lot of significant work with patients in primary care, including very, very complex patients, then a lot of folks who are new to, say, PCBH, for example, are sort of aware of or willing to give it credit for. So I think a lot of it comes from that. If you're early on, you tend to over-refer quite a bit because you're just not quite, you don't understand primary care very well, potentially. And I think it also comes from certain biases, you know, just certain ideas in our minds about what's most helpful, and, you know, sort of this idea that sort of like everybody needs psychotherapy. And, you know, I felt like that was sort of drilled into me when I was in training. You know, everybody in the world could use psychotherapy. Like, really? I mean, like, yes. And is there a version of psychotherapy that maybe isn't as intensive, right? And that's really a key issue here, right? There's nothing wrong with psychotherapy, and there's varying levels even within psychotherapy, right? There's a lot of worried well people that just go to a therapist and kind of hang out and for years and just kind of talk about what's going on in their lives and things like that. It just becomes one part of their whole sort of coping strategy. And then there's like really intensive forms of psychotherapy and other specialty interventions, by the way. We're not just talking about psychotherapy here. We're talking about ACT teams, psychiatry, care management, et cetera. And folks who need a pretty intense, especially in a particular episode of care, need that specialty care, right? But everybody doesn't need specialty mental health. We may need specialty mental health in certain increments in our lives at different points for different reasons. But the idea that everybody should just jump to that level, Well, that's a recipe for disaster, and that's part of why our health system is as, you know, screwed up as it is. So we're trying to solve that, and a big part of that solution is creating a primary care level of care. So the question is, when do you refer, right? Well, here are a list of characteristics that I want you to think about when you're thinking about referring out. The top and the number one thing that I have written down here on my desk is, what is the likelihood of completion of that referral? Right? That's a key issue. And in fact, it's a statistical issue. A statistical issue that affects not just referrals from primary care to mental health, but actually referrals from primary care to any other specialty. Referral completion is not 100% for any category, right? So the question is, what is your referral completion rate? And I go like this because I always often use this analogy of like rolling the dice, right? Because that's what it is. When you refer someone out, you're rolling the dice that they're going to go out, make that referral, and that referral is going to be a helpful referral. In other words, what you hoped happen will happen with regard to treatment with that individual, right? So the likelihood of referral is can be based on a bunch of different factors, which you can imagine, right? Like a referral relates to what options they have. Do they have a lot of access in their community? Do they have the right kinds of insurance or ways, means of paying? If they are uninsured and you're sending them to a clinic that is a free clinic or a clinic that works particularly with underserved folks, do they have access? Is there a wait list? Is there a long wait list, et cetera? So likelihood of referral is one of those questions you need to ask. And if you tell yourself, boy, there's a 50-50 chance, you're rolling the dice on a 50% chance that something's going to happen, right? And it may not. And if so, then what are you going to do, right? So likelihood of referral is one of the first things you should be asking yourself as far when you're thinking about whether to refer someone out or not. Now, closely related to that, of course, is what's the patient's motivation? Is the patient motivated for this particular referral? And I've found a lot of times that clinicians use their own motivation. I really believe you need specialty mental health. You need psychotherapy. You need to see a psychiatrist. You need care management. You need an ACT team, whatever it is you need on a specialty level. I have the motivation, but they fail to check in on the patient's motivation. Sorry about that. Just hit my microphone. So if the patient is not sufficiently motivated, it doesn't matter how much you think they need. They're not going to go. If they're not going to go, you can't just wash your hands and say, well, I referred them, right? No, they're still going to come back to primary care. They're still going to be a challenge for the care team. So then at that point, the question is not whether you refer out, but what kind of care can we provide here, potentially to bridge some of that gap, potentially to motivate that person over time, potentially to go to that referral source, or just simply to be helpful, right? To be as helpful as you can be at the primary care level. And again, this is not unusual. It happens with other referrals as well. There are patients who don't want to go see another specialist. They say, doc, I trust you. I trust you. I don't want to see that person. And the doc has to figure that out and say, okay, well, they sort of enter in a little bit of a negotiation with the patient sometimes around what they can do versus what the specialty clinician can do, right? So patient motivation, that's a huge, huge component. Here's a key question. What is it that you envision will improve? What's the target improvement in that patient's life? A key reason why specialty referrals to mental health often don't work very well is because there's not a clear reason for the referral. There's more like a clear sort of sense of affect or urgency around the referral, often on the part of the team or the clinician, right? It's like, oh my goodness, you're so complex. I feel overwhelmed and I just feel like you need something more, right? Well, that's not good enough. If you're going to send someone to a specialist, it should be a specific reason. Like, what is it you're trying to improve here, right? What is not improving here in primary care that will improve there, right? And that's actually another subset question. It's not just what is the target improvement that you hope specialty mental health will provide for the patient, but what is the target improvement that specialty mental health can provide specifically or uniquely that primary care cannot? And when you clarify that, both for yourself in your case conceptualization and for the care team and for the patient and for the referral source, then you have a better recipe for a good referral completion and good initiation of care. Because what you often don't realize is if you just send a cold referral, what will happen is that person is just going to be reprocessed at that other place. They're going to reevaluate and they may come to a different conclusion than you as to what services that patient needs or wants, right? Or what the urgency of those services are. I can tell how many times I've sent a patient to a place and I want them to get psychiatry services. They go to the place and they get psychotherapy services. I'm like, that's not helping us. That's not the target improvement that I was hoping to get, right? And so that key question is huge. What is a target improvement and what is the difference in what specialty mental health can provide than what we can provide here in primary care? Is the timing right? Right? That's a crucial question. Is it the right time for the patient? Are they in a good place for it? Are they able to sustain the intervention that is needed, right? So for example, I've had patients with trauma. They definitely could use some specialty mental health. And theoretically, they want to. But in truth, they're not ready. They're not ready to enter into their trauma at that level. And so if they go and start and then discontinue because they're just not ready, or just things in their life are not ready logistically, they don't have the time, starting a new job, whatever it is, guess what? They're going to discontinue. The health center, the special mental health clinic is going to be upset. They may not let them come in for a specified time period because of the no-show and all that kind of a thing. So timing, is it the right time? Both for the patient and as far as their ability to access. That whole question of can the patient sustain the intervention is also a really, really key question to hone in on. Can the patient sustain the intervention is a reflection of the reality that intensive services are not just helpful to the patient, they are also taxing to the patient. In other words, there is an investment that a patient needs to make in order to get something out of those services. By definition, primary care has a lower level of investment, right? It's just easier to get in and out of. There's not a lot required of patients typically in the interaction. For specialty mental health, there is a lot of interaction. There may be like weekly visits, for example, right, with a therapist. There may be more emotional work that a therapist is asking a patient to engage in. Back to that example of that patient with trauma is just kind of not ready to process their trauma quite yet, right? So these are things that we need to be aware of, that this level of investment actually requires something on the part of the patient. They may not be ready for that. They may not be able to sustain it. I've had patients, again, with, say, bipolar disorder, who, because of the instability of their underlying functioning, can't really sustain engagement with specialty mental health very well. And so they get kicked out. And then, you know, again, right back to us. So a lot of times then we focus on trying to increase the level of overall stability so that they can then sustain some of the more intensive work that they might get in specialty mental health. And then last but not least, you always want to be thinking of what will be the ongoing work here in primary care? Because you're not referring someone and then that's it, washing your hands. They're always your patient. They're always the care patient, the care team's patient. So, you know, the question is not, do I refer and forget? But it's actually, all right, we're going to refer. And how is it that I, as a consultant, will continue to support the primary care provider's work with this patient, right? Because the primary care provider is still engaging with that patient across a variety of health issues. And so it becomes my job to figure out, okay, what does that look like here? In a lot of cases, we'll still continue to prescribe, say, some of their psychotropic medications while they might be seeing a therapist externally. Sometimes they might be seeing a psychiatrist externally, but they're still getting their MAT meds here with us, right? So our relationship continues. It just changes by virtue of the fact that there is a specialist now involved. Right? So it's not a bad thing to refer folks out, but it really should be one of the more mindful activities you engage in. And again, if you find yourself reflexively referring people out or referring out without really processing it in the way that I've outlined, you're more than likely just simply going to end up pretty frustrated because you're going to find that your hit rate on that referral completion is pretty low. And you're going to end up having to do a lot of the work anyway because they're going to keep coming back. They're going to keep being a concern for you in primary care. Now, I'll wrap up by making these comments here that you've noticed probably that I haven't talked a lot about severity as a key indicator of whether someone needs specialty mental health versus primary care. And that's because I don't think severity is a great indicator. There are lots of folks that I've seen with pretty severe forms of mental health symptoms that have done great in primary care. And frankly, there have been lots of folks that I've seen with some mild to moderate type stuff that have done great in specialty care, right? So I don't think severity is a great indicator. I think a lot of what we should be thinking about with regard to the impact of specialty mental health is what specialty mental health does well, right? So what does specialty mental health do well? Well, if you're a therapist doing specialty mental health, you do well with issues that do well in a context that requires expansive amounts of time, you know, weekly visits, hour-long visits, and that require episodes of care that can sometimes be a little bit longer. So you're doing weekly visits over several months, if not an entire year. That's where psychotherapy is going to shine, right? And so if I see a patient who would benefit from that, whether they're severe, mild, or moderate, that's going to be potentially a good place for that kind of patient, assuming they pass that screen from those other questions that we just talked about, right? And so, you know, if I think about psychiatry and I think about what is psychiatry effective for, you know, and I think psychiatry is good for really complicated situations where a patient has failed multiple trials of medication, where there may be medication interactions because of other health conditions that are very complicated, and where really maybe we've tried a bunch of different things here in primary care, they just haven't worked out terribly well. That's where psychiatry does really, really well and shines, right? So I'm going to refer patients in those situations. I'm not going to refer someone for like run-of-the-mill depression. Like that just is not, that's a waste of psychiatry time. It's not anything different than what we're probably going to accomplish, you know, in primary care, right? So again, you can think about each of the services you might refer to, whether it's case management or some sort of peer support, whatever it is, you want to really be targeted and think, what is it that this service does really well at? And does that fit what I'm hoping this patient gets? Last comment here, and that is that a lot of times I think we pretend in our minds, I've talked about this before, we have this sort of magical thinking about referring out that somehow these big problems in a patient's life, there's a solution out there in specialty mental health land. And I think that's unfair to specialty mental health. It's unfair to primary care, honestly, but especially unfair to specialty mental health to ask them to be that magical place where all mental health problems get solved. There are some problems that just don't have a solution in the mental health realm. We've talked about that before in other videos around social determinants of health, really complex patient situations, et cetera. So sometimes, you know, you might want to catch yourself a little bit, especially when you ask yourself that question, what's the target improvement, right? And you realize the target improvement I want is for this person to have another life. I was like, that's not what special mental health does any more than primary care. All right. Hopefully this has spurred some thoughts, helped clarify that, and hopefully you can work on refining your referral threshold to refer or not refer. Ask yourself the right questions. For the Collaborative Family Healthcare Association, I'm Dr. Naftali Serrano. Until next time.